It's my pleasure to present today controversies in recurrent implantation failure. This will be my agenda: introduction, incidents, controversies in the definition, possible etiology, recommended investigation, controversies in the management, and conclusion.
Dr. Harman, please, may you maximize your screen, please?
Okay. Okay.
No, yeah. you will find the sign in the bottom, the sign of maximizing the screen.
It's okay.
Yeah, perfect.
Implantation is a process whereby the blastocyst attach itself to the luminal surface of the endometrium, followed by migration and invasion. It occurs about 10 days after fertilization, usually in the upper trans segment, and it passes by four stages: opposition, adhesion, communication, and then invasion. Why we present RIF today? Because it is a very distressing and frustrating condition for the patient, the clinician, and scientist. And the incidence is about 10% of women seeking IVF treatment. Implantation failure means failure of the embryo to reach a stage when an intrauterine gestational sac is recognized by ultrasound. And the implantation rate is the number of embryos which produce intrauterine gestational sac by the total number of the embryo transferred. In IVF, it's about 25% for day two or three, and it's about 40% for blastocyst. Regarding the controversies in the definition, nowadays there is no universally accepted definition for RIF. However, these are the variables which has to be included in the definition: the number of trial, number of transferred embryo, age of the patient, and embryo quality. Initially, RIF defined as a cumulative transfer of 8 embryos or 4 blastocysts not leading to a positive pregnancy test 14 days after oocyte pickup. However, issue definition: failure to achieve clinical pregnancy after 3 or more unsuccessful transfer of high quality embryo, or after the cumulative transfer of 10 or more embryo in multiple transfer. In a relevant systematic review, including 119 studies, the most common single variable used for the definition was the number of failed cycle, which was more than 3. Using the number of embryos transferred cumulatively in combination with the number of failed cycle, the most common definition was cumulative transfer of 10 or more embryo during 3 or more failed cycle. But in the era of single embryo transfer, the definition of RIF should be revised. More recently, it is defined as failure to achieve a clinical pregnancy after a transfer of at least 4 good quality embryo in a minimum of 3 fresh or frozen cycle in a woman less than 40. Why we have to have good quality embryo, and why 4 not 10, and why we have 8 frozen plus fresh, and why the age is less than 40. By good quality embryo, we mean if we transfer embryo, the number of the blastomere has to be corresponding to the day of its development, and the size has to be equal and regular in distribution, and the cytoplasm has to be even, and the fragment is less than 10%. And for blastocyst, has to be expanded with good quality inner cell mass and good quality trophoctoderm. Why fresh and frozen? Because implantation rate for frozen thawed embryo nowadays is similar to that of the fresh, and so we have to add frozen embryo thawed in the definition. And why the age has to be less than 40? Because the embryo quality is closely related to age, and there is increased chromosomal non-disjunction and aneuploid embryo and mitochondrial damage with age. Why 4 not 10? Because the implantation rate increases as a result of improved culture environment and quality of the culture media, increasing use of blastocyst transfer, which means natural selection of better quality embryo, and so the definition has to be 4-3-40. What are the possible causes? The possible causes may be divided into sperm causes, oocyte causes, embryo causes, and when you put the embryo inside the womb, it might be endometrial causes, cavity causes, wall causes, then it might be tubal, or ovarian factor or transfer procedure itself. And it might be a multifactorial problem. Multifactorial may be related to lifestyle factor, endocrine factor, immunological factors, thrombophilic condition, which will be discussed by Dr. Ashraf, and suboptimal condition of ovarian stimulation, lab condition, and the process of ET itself. However, the recommended investigation for RIF nowadays is considered to be hysteroscopy for the cavity, esophagogram for the tube, 3D and 2D for the pelvis, ovarian reserve testing, parent karyotyping, and if there is abnormality in parent karyotyping, we advise to do CCS. Investigation of research value include investigation for thrombophilia and sperm DNA fragmentation. What about the controversies in the treatment strategy? It will be controversies related to the lifestyle changes, something related to the sperm or oocyte embryo, or related to the uterus, endometrium, cavity, and wall, or endocrine factors, immunological factor, thrombophilic factor, and other, like the use of atrazine, the role of high progesterone on the day of HCG triggering, and the new policy of freeze hold. Regarding the management, the lifestyle changes, definitely diet, smoking, alcohol, and the body mass index affect the result. Maternal obesity and smoking are negatively associated with implantation and the clinical pregnancy and live birth rate. However, no data exists to support direct association with RIF. Regarding the sperm, it will include the MC versus ICSI and sperm DNA fragmentation. MC has been proposed as a treatment for RIF based on a subgroup analysis of N randomized controlled trial in patients younger than 35 with two or more failed attempts and who were treated by MC or ICSI. The effectiveness of MC is still controversial due to many confounding variables in ART program, and so further randomized controlled trial still needed. This is a long list of trials comparing MC versus ICSI. What about sperm DNA fragmentation? Multiple studies have reported the negative effect of high sperm DNA fragmentation on clinical pregnancy following IVF ICSI treatment. However, the hypothesis that sperm DNA fragmentation is an important cause of RIF is not supported by the current published literature. And so, no obvious difference in sperm DNA fragmentation were present between patients with RIF and fertile group in a study done by Coggin 2015. What about oocyte? You have to improve oocyte quality and by stimulation protocol. During the stimulation protocol, you have to adopt ICOS, individualized controlled ovarian stimulation, that say to choose the proper medication and the proper protocol for the proper patient, and the addition of growth hormone. And then what about cytoplasmic transfer? Regarding growth hormone, the administration of growth hormone during controlled ovarian stimulation improves success rate in poor responder by exerting a beneficial effect on oocyte quality. Regarding RIF, a high probability of live births have been observed in a randomized controlled trial comparing co-treatment with growth hormone versus no co-treatment. However, this study has not yet been repeated and its conclusion was based on analysis of only 70 patients. What about cytoplasmic transfer? Cytoplasmic transfer between oocytes was initially developed for infertile patients, exhibiting persistent poor embryonic development and RIF, resulting in births of several children worldwide. But this method should be strictly experimental because there is no relevant randomized controlled trial and the long-term health effect of induced mitochondrial heteroplasmy in the children born is not yet known. What about the embryo? We have to improve embryo quality and to have a better selection for the embryo using another thing apart from the morphology of the embryo, like metabolomics. And we might adopt the transfer of large number of embryo to use blasted transfer instead of cleavage state, the rule of assisted hatching, the BGT-A, and the use of co-culture of embryo, and the use of hyaluronic acid in rich transfer medium and donor oocyte sperm and embryo. Regarding the pre-implantation genetic testing for aneuploidy, the aim is to transfer chromosomally normal embryo. In a retrospective study, significantly higher pregnancy rate were present following the array comparative genomic hybridization as compared to ET without BGTA. However, the therapeutic value of this strategy need to be confirmed in a relevant randomized controlled trial. Assisted hatching, although assisted hatching has been shown to increase the probability of live birth in women with RIF, this was based on a pooled analysis of two small randomized controlled trials, including 250 patients. However, there is a specific complication for assisted hatching, like lethal damage to the embryo and individual blastomere with reduction of embryo viability and increased risk of monozygotic twin pregnancy. And so further research are needed before its application in routine clinical practice. Co-culture and the hyaluronic acid enriched transfer media. The use of co-culture and the hyaluronic acid enriched media have been claimed to increase the probability of pregnancy in RIF patients. Regarding co-culture, this is based on data from retrospective studies, and for hyaluronic acid, a higher clinical pregnancy rate versus an ongoing pregnancy and delivery rate have been reported in one randomized controlled trial. The effect of hyaluronic acid enriched transfer media on frozen sod ET was observed, however, it is used for, and the recommendation, it can improve implantation rate and the clinical pregnancy rate in patients with recurrent implantation failure in the third or more frozen embryo transfer attempt. However, its use for the first and second should be done with caution. What about the endometrium cavity and wall? Regarding the endometrium, the role of chronic endometritis and endometrial injury, and the cavity, what about polyp septum myoma adhesion and the wall? What about the intramural myoma and adenomyosis? Chronic endometritis, a higher incidence in patients with RIF ranging about from 15 to 60% as compared to asymptomatic infertile patients before their first IVF trial. However, scarce data exists regarding the value of antibiotic for treating women with chronic endometritis and RIF. In a retrospective study, similar ongoing pregnancy rates were observed between women with histologically confirmed chronic endometritis who were either treated or not by antibiotic, and so no relevant randomized controlled trial right now. What about endometrial injury? Endometrial injury has been proposed as a method to increase the probability of pregnancy both in the overall population and in patients with RIF. The probable mechanism is improving decellularization, cytokine release, growth factor, stem cell recruitment. However, current published studies are of moderate quality and apply different methods of endometrial injury in different types of patients. A systematic and meta-analysis by the Cochrane group in women who had more than two failed ET, that include 474 women in four randomized controlled trials, a significant increase of probability was observed after endometrial scratching. However, again, the quality of evidence was considered to be low. In 2019, a randomized trial of endometrial scratch before IVF proved that it is of no value. And another endometrial scratching prior to IVF, does it help and for whom? And the conclusion for that study was, despite the publication of multiple randomized controlled trials in the past 10 years, it remained unclear whether we should scratch the endometrium prior to IVF or no. I think everyone agree with me that any intratrial lesion like myoma, polyp septum adhesion should be corrected before trialing another trial. Endometrial polyp, the incidence is up to 45 in RIF patient and about 20 in the first ART trial due to the lack of high quality prospective study. Their proposed unfavorable effect on implantation is based on indirect evidence from study comparing IVF outcome in patient with and without polyp. This study, however, have also produced controversial results supporting or negating a beneficial effect of polypectin. However, if there is a polyp more than 1 centimeter near to the fundus, it has to be removed. Regarding myoma, any submucous myoma of any type negatively affect IVF outcome and implantation, and it has to be done. Regarding subserosa and myoma have no impact, and regarding intramural myoma, it might exert a negative impact, and this effect is maybe related to their number and diameter. The mechanism on endometrial receptivity is not clear, and a beneficial effect of removal has not been shown in a meta-analysis. A Cochrane systematic review suggested that the effect of myomectomy on fertility couldn't be evaluated due to insufficient published evidence. And simply speaking, submucous myoma has to be removed. Regarding adenomyosis, the published data analysis suggests that its presence is associated with significantly lower clinical pregnancy rate. But significant heterogeneity included in the study limits the value of this conclusion, and the mechanism is still unclear. And the best treatment approach is still unknown, and no comparative study exists between conservative and surgical treatment. Moreover, the consequences of surgical treatment for a future pregnancy haven't been evaluated. For hydrocervix, it has to be treated whether serpingectomy, serpingostomy, disconnection, or occlusion, laparoscopic or hysteroscopic. Regarding endocrine factor, the endocrine disorder may affect implantation through the interaction of various hormones with their corresponding receptors in the endometrium. We'll speak about vitamin D deficiency, PCOS, and thyroid disease. The mechanism, the exact rule, is not yet fully understood. Regarding the L-thyroxine supplementation, conflicting evidence exists regarding the value of thyroxine supplementation for increasing the probability of delivery and lowering the probability of miscarriage rate in women with subclinical hypothyroidism or euthyroid women with TSH concentration above 2.5. And there is no information is currently available in RIF. Again, the probability of live birth in women with thyroid autoimmunity is significantly lower compared to women without thyroid anti-immunity. And again, there is no information is currently available in RIF. Vitamin D supplementation. In a meta-analysis, in a woman undergoing ART, the probability of live birth was significantly higher in women deplete in vitamin D as compared to women with deficient or inefficient vitamin D. However, no data exists to support vitamin D supplementation in the general population or in women with RIF. Metformin, although it has been shown that early pregnancy loss is significantly decreased in women with PCOS treated with metformin, it's not yet known whether such treatment is beneficial for RIF patient. What about immunological factor and immunotherapy? Immune inflammatory factors such as antiphospholipid antibody, antinuclear antibody, and dysregulated T and natural killer cell mediated immune response play a role in RIF. The immune therapeutic modulator include prednisone, intravenous immunoglobulin, hydroxychloroquine, intrauterine administration of HCG, intrauterine or subcutaneous granulocyte colon stimulating factor administration. Regarding intravenous immunoglobulin, it increased the probability of live birth in a meta-analysis based on pooling data from three supposed to be randomized controlled trials. However, one of these studies was not a randomized control, and the second study, the included patient cannot be strictly classified as RIF, and so currently published evidence does not support the use of IVIG in RIF patients. The same could be applied for intralipid since there is poor quality evidence of its use. Hydroxychloroquine is an anti-malaria drug used as treatment in various autoimmune disease, particularly systemic lupus. Its immunomodulatory effect has led to its administration in patients with RIF. However, currently there is a lack of randomized controlled trial supporting its effectiveness in RIF patients. Granulocyte colon stimulating factor, a recent meta-analysis showed that the probability of clinical pregnancy was increased in patients with RIF after its administration, and this result was based on pooling data from 5 abstracts and 3 fully published papers. What about intrauterine administration of autologous peripheral mononuclear cell? It's freshly isolated from the patient. It might be beneficial in a randomized controlled trial in 2015. It evokes cytokine and proteases. However, no relevant randomized control trial are found right now. Intrauterine administration of HCG, whatever synthetic or natural, around the time of ET, the mechanism it might promote peritrophoblastic immune tolerance, which facilitate trophoblastic invasion by inducing and increasing the endometrial T cell apoptosis. However, no study in RIF till now. Administration of atrazine to minimize uterine contraction, a recently published meta-analysis in RIF patient show an increased probability of live birth by the use of atrazine. Only two randomized controlled trials, including 390 patients, and so further trials are required. What about progesterone? Elevated progesterone level on the day of triggering of final oocyte maturation may negatively associated with implantation and pregnancy. Women with a history of progesterone elevation have approximately 6 times higher odds of exhibiting progesterone elevation in their next cycle. The study of Lee demonstrated that in women with two previous failed IVF trials had a significant higher prevalence of progesterone elevation compared with women with one failed IVF ET or no failed IVF ET. A single prospective cohort study demonstrated a significant higher probability of ongoing pregnancy in women with RIF treated by freeze-all approach as compared to women treated with fresh transfer. What about freeze-all? What is the hypothesis? Transfer of embryo in normal endometrium of a natural or artificially prepared cycle bypass the effect of ovarian stimulation on endometrial receptivity. This strategy increases the probability of pregnancy in high responder patients. However, data for patients with RIF are still not available. In summary, this table demonstrates the intervention from randomized control trial or meta-analysis that appear to offer. It's very important to remember appear to offer. There is no solid data till now. Appear to offer a benefit in RIF patient, including gross hormone, the use of hyaluronic acid, assisted hatching, atrazine, endometrial scratching, and CCF. Treatment of proven benefit in reality include only hysteroscopic correction for myoma, for polyp, and for septum, tubal disconnection, blastocyst transfer for natural selection, and maybe assisted hatching. In conclusion, RIF is a multifactorial condition. Preventable category should be recognized and dealt with before IVF, hysteroscopy, pelvic ultrasound, ovarian reserve testing, parent karyotyping are needed as an investigation, and management should be individualized, aimed at improving sperm, oocyte, embryo, endometrial receptivity, and few intervention are evidence-based, gamete donation or surrogacy may be necessary. And finally, I'd like from you to remember your patient that we are not expecting to give a baby for every single couple coming to our clinic, and we don't have a magic key, and the miracle does not happen, at least in our hand. And to remember yourself to do your best and never frustrated, and to remember yourself and your patient that implantation, pregnancy, live birth is a gift of God. Thank you for your attention.